Hey folks, this is Sebastian and welcome to the second part of our three-parter on frequency spectra of the smartphones. In this part we will have a look at the magnetic spectrum and why sometimes we see more frequencies than we expect. In the last video we had a look at the audio spectrum of a guitar and how to optimize its resolution. If you haven't seen it, you might want to check it out before continuing with this video, because today we will continue where we left off. So one thing we noticed last time was that sometimes we see more peaks than we expect. In fact, we were playing one tone, but we were seeing a whole range of different peaks in our frequency spectrum. Let's have a look at this with some examples using the magnetic spectrum.
The magnetometer can detect very small magnetic fields, which can be generated by electric currents or permanent magnets. Here is an example of the magnetic spectrum when riding a train. This signal stems from the railway AC electrification, which runs at 16.7 Hz in Germany. You can also attach permanent magnets to rotating objects to determine their frequency, which is what we did with the fidget spinner many years ago and what is common for bicycle speedometers, although those simply measure the time between passes of the magnet instead of calculating a Fourier transform. If we try this with our bike, we can clearly see how it slows down over time. However, we now have many overlapping peaks similar to what we had in the older video with the fidget spinner. Why is that? As mentioned before, the spectrum is a result of a Fourier transform. This does not simply analyze the frequency of a periodic signal, but it tries to recreate the measured signal as a combination of sine functions with different frequencies. This here is a sine function, and the spectrum we see means that we take a sine function at one frequency, add a tiny amount of a sine function at another frequency, add a large contribution at an even higher frequency, and so on until we get the original signal. The raw signal of our bicycle wheel looks like this, not anywhere near a simple sine function. It is periodic and we could name a specific frequency, but a Fourier transform will insist on assembling it from many different sine functions. An extreme example would be a square wave. To construct it, we start with a sine function at its base frequency, at a higher frequency to get those edges closer, and at another one, and at another one, and so on. The Fourier transform of a square function has many frequencies. And similarly, you will see additional frequencies for anything that is not a perfect sine function.
These peaks are called overtones, and this is also what we've seen for the guitar. And it's what makes the sound of a guitar more interesting and unique than, let's say, a recorder, at least in my opinion. There's one more thing I would like to address. When I showed you the electrification frequency of the German railway, you might have wondered if you could also see the frequency of your power outlets. In Germany, that's around 50 Hz. In the US, for example, it's 60 Hz. Those two frequencies are the most common one around the world. And the answer would be probably not, and if you see something from your power outlet, it's probably the wrong frequency. Like in this example, this is from a user from the US who should have seen 60 Hz, but instead he saw 40 Hz. This effect is called the alias effect, and that's what we will discuss in the next video when we also try out the acceleration spectrum with the engine of a car and the rotation frequency of a hard disk drive. If you want to learn more about our free and open source app VFox, check out vfox.org. Also, if you want to support us in one form or another, check out vfox.org/contribute, where we listed a few things that could really help us out. So check out the links in the video description. Thanks for watching and see you in the final video of this little series.